and welcome to Wolverhampton Literature Festival in our special In Conversation with Patrick Vernon. We are joined by social activist Patrick Vernon and also playwright and local historian Jefny Ashcroft. Now, if you would like to ask Patrick any questions, please do head to Twitter and use hashtag AskPatrickV, and we will filter those questions at the end. Thank you. And I'm going to pass over to our speakers.
Right, well, Patrick and I know each other.
Yes, yeah. Quite a while now. I don't know how many years now.
Oh, quite a while, isn't it?
Yeah.
In the Express and Star, that august organ,
yes,
which has an article about you today,
okay,
it talks about you having been vocal in the past about the Black Country flag and the links to the slave trade. And you say that the issues still need to be discussed in an open forum.
Yes.
Well, this is a sort of open forum, so yeah. I wonder if you'd like to start telling us a bit about that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it must have been about 2015 or so where it was brought to my attention about the logo or the chain motif and the Black Country flag, and I just simply raised my concerns and objections. I never ran a campaign to ban the flag. I think it's important to celebrate local history. You know, I'm from Wolverhampton, born and raised. I'm very familiar, you know, I'm a yam-yam, sort of, maybe.
Better than me, I only came in 75.
Okay, don't worry, you're invited, you're still allowed. So, you know, I was born in Wolverhampton, went to school in Wolverhampton. I'm very familiar with the history of the Black Country and the Industrial Revolution and all that stuff. So obviously celebrating local history is important, and local industrial heritage history and working-class history is also important. But also part of working-class history is about the Black experience. We have a working class history. Unfortunately, part of that history was about enslavement and slavery, enforced labour, and the Black Country during the height of the Industrial Revolution played a significant role in creating chains, manacles, fetters, padlocks, which were used on slave ships, which as part of that triangle trade from the UK to Africa and then to the Caribbean and North America and South America. And since Britain had the monopoly making these chains, and the Black Country played a key role in that, the chains all came from the Black Country. And so they enslaved my ancestors on the ships, on the plantations in the Caribbean, and in North America and South America, and then they were used in colonial times in Africa. So when they launched the flag and the particular chain motif, I just simply said, hold on here, have you done your research work? Do you know what you did? What happened, you know, over 200 years ago around the chainmaker industry and how it was used during the time of during slavery? And unfortunately, I got hate mail, objections. People said I was creating divisions in Wolverhampton. Well, talk to my parents. They came to Wolverhampton in 1958. They experienced the colour bar and discrimination. So let's talk about those kind of divisions. Mm. So, but let's put that to one side. And I just simply said, I didn't lead a campaign to ban the flag. I simply said that the flag needs to acknowledge that the history of chain making is also linked to the history of enslavement. And as we know, I mean, I live in London now. I've been living in London for a number of years. And in London, quite a few London boroughs have done a lot of research work looking at their slave past. In Liverpool, they've done the same thing. Also in Bristol. And the only part of the country that does not talk about this history is in the West Midlands, and particularly the Black Country. So I'll just simply put out a provocation to say, let's have a conversation, a mature conversation. But unfortunately, it got personalised. I got seen as a bogeyman, so it's unfortunate. But I hope, on the back of Black Lives Matter, that's led to a national conversation, as we now know, about what is history, what is the narrative of Britain. And so I think this is a perfect opportunity to explore that. So, which kind of leads on to why I'm here, to talk about the importance of Black history. That is only one element of that, but it's also about celebrating, acknowledging the Black contribution in Wolverhampton.
Can we just go back to the other point, mind you, because you know I'm on your side in this.
Yeah.
I mean, one thing that interested me was that not the current archivist, but the one before, David Bishop, actually wrote something about what he'd found in a trade directory,
yes,
in the archives.
Oh, yes.
And that, and it's not just chains, of course. Specifically, I have seen the entry. Mm. It's somebody who made, let's say, John Smith,
yes,
in Wolverhampton, who made Negro collars. collars, and they are they are specifically metal collars for holding people's necks, and so that is a very concrete. Myself as a local historian have seen that example of what you're talking about. I think one of the problems is that most people in the Black Country see chains purely in terms of industry and don't realise because they don't want to, I suspect. That in fact, one of those industries in a way was, of course, the providers of of labour, the slaves. So people are very defensive, there's no doubt about it, aren't they?
I mean, I appreciate that because, I mean, I've been to the Black Country Museum loads of times. I've been to, you know, and I know that the history of chain making is important. And one of the objections that's been raised is, you know, white working class people were also given a hard time by the manufacturers. I agree with that. But don't negate the experiences of Black people who are also experiencing that. You know, it's almost like, you know, let's talk about our experiences and ignore my experiences. And with all due respect, you can't compare people who were taken away from their villages, you know, murdered, killed, abused physically and sexually on slave ships for about 3 to 4 months, living in feces, compared to the working conditions in the furnace. There's no comparison. So I want people to acknowledge that.
Yes, but at the moment I know, and I have to be careful, I came to Wolverhampton, like I said, about 1975. I feel very strongly that I'm Wolfronian. I work in Dudley occasionally, and Dudley people in particular feel, after all, the Black Country flag emerged from there, the festival really emerged from there. Very defensive. They do feel the white working class is being criticised. And of course, we know as socialists that the white working class didn't make huge amounts of money out of black people's misery, but unfortunately that was used by the masters to create that misery. And it's not attacking the white working class to point that out to people.
It's a shared history. We have a shared history. And this is the history of Britain. It's a shared history of, and we've all had experiences of discrimination and oppression. The white slaves at Cradle Heath and the women in 1902 who said enough is enough. That is a shared history of liberation for women. It's the same experiences for the black experience. So let's have an inclusive conversation as opposed to having just only exclusive conversation.
As I said, you and I agree on this one, but I know it causes real problems with people. And I do think it's quite significant because there is racism in Britain. There is racism in the Black Country, of course. Black Country is part of Britain.
Sure.
And I think sometimes that over-defensiveness is this sort of, how could the white working class possibly be, they do feel attacked, traditionalists, let's call them that. And that's not what's happening. We're talking about, as you said, inclusive history. But I think we've given that a bit of an airing, do you?
Yeah, it's fine. I mean, I'm sure the conversation will continue. And, hopefully at some stage, I hope that the organisers start to look at inclusion. And it's not enough having an odd black person to say, I love the flag. It's about looking at the history.
And there's quite a lot of work to do, isn't there?
Yes.
I mean, I'm trying to keep my trap shut because you also say in here there'll be some humour. because I've written plays about people in the Black Country.
Yes.
And indeed, can I ask you a question at this point? Wolverhampton is dear to my heart and yours.
Yes.
But also, I have written something about Smethwick, which some people might argue is not in the Black Country, actually. But still. And I just wonder if we could mention that, because today is a rather important anniversary in some ways.
Certainly is. I mean, and it's great that you brought it to our attention that, you know, today, this day, Malcolm X came all the way from America, came to Smethwick, and went to, is it Marshall Street?
Marshall Street, yeah.
And that's where he met a number of race campaigners, activists, and inspired lots of people, actually. So everyone, today, Malcolm X was in Britain in 1965, also the same year as the first Race Relations Act in 1965 as well.
But after 1964, where there was a dirty racist campaign by the Conservative candidate who actually beat the Labour candidate in 64.
Yeah.
I think I've got that right. I wrote a film about it for children called How Do You Know That? And so it's a particular interest of mine. As I said to you just now when we were waiting, it was wonderful, school children 14 to 18 who came to see the play in Smethwick Archives, by the way, and right next to the Blue Gates pub, where Malcolm X had actually been, despite being a black Muslim. He went in there with a friend of mine, Aftar Jewell, to have a half of beer.
Yes.
Supposedly, because there was a colour bar in the pub. So the kids were right next door to that pub, and some of them had come from a school from near Marshall Street.
Yes.
And they didn't necessarily know about Malcolm X. And if you look on the film, which is on my website, after the play, you'll see these 14 to 18 year olds really happy, black, white, Asian, ordinary kids from ordinary school in Smethwick saying, we didn't know about Malcolm X, we're so pleased we've seen the play. Mm-hmm. So this, I'm very interested in how we get, in fact, black history to local children and, of course, nationally. And that has proved a problem in the past, hasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I've been to quite a few schools, especially in London and other parts of the country, where school teachers are really doing their best. And actually, in Wolverhampton, that reminds me of West Park Primary School, where they did that fantastic production of Rivers of Blood in 1968. Mike, if you're in Shrewsbury, nice one, brother. That West Park Primary School, and he worked with the school to create this fantastic production, along with Dr. Shun Hurst, who's at Wolverhampton University, who's now at the People's Museum in Manchester. And I think working with schools and educating schools and young people about history is really, really important. We don't do enough of it. We need to do more of it. It's a pity that the current national curriculum is not inclusive enough around, not just simply about black history, but all histories.
Very much so. I went to the West Park thing and it was fantastic. And I don't know her name. I don't know if she's still there, but I thought the head teacher was brilliant there as well. Yeah. So one of the issues there was that she had not only children from Wolverhampton, black, white, Asian, but she also had a lot of refugee children.
Yes.
And part of what she was trying to do with the play was to get them feeling included. And
It's funny because after the play, the next day, I was invited to school and I might have met year five or year six, I can't remember now. And they were asking me loads of questions and they just reflected multicultural Britain, Eastern Europe, Africa, the Caribbean, white working class, everyone was there. And they were all asking questions about what I've done in my career, because most of my main career I've done is I've worked in senior management in healthcare. So I had to talk about my journey and then I talked about my passion around campaigns, particularly around Windrush. And it just felt quite an honour just to engage with the young people.
I was very impressed. If all schools did that, it would be fantastic.
Yes.
And parents loved it, of course.
Oh yes, I think it's fantastic. I don't know if it'd be great if they did this again. Actually, I don't know if they have to wait another 50 years for it, but hopefully, it won't be that long.
Now you said Windrush.
Yeah.
Can we talk about that?
Sure.
And come with me. Because I knew her very slightly and you knew her a lot better.
Yeah.
Windrush always means Paulette Wilson.
Yes.
Do you want to talk about that?
I knew Paulette very well. Obviously Paulette was, a victim of the Windrush scandals, we all now know. And sadly she died July of last year. And we are, a family are still in distraught, especially her daughter, Natalie, who I'm in regular contact with. And working with the current mayor of Wolverhampton, and Councillor Sandra Samuels and others, and the family, we're hoping that we'll have a blue plaque later on this year to celebrate and acknowledge her achievements, her life, and her legacy. But her story is part of that wider eco-story of the Windrush generation and the history of, particularly, of the Jamaican community in Wolverhampton. So it's my story, it's my parents' story, it's other people's stories coming here, invited here, came here when in Wolverhampton, and I was just recently interviewed my parents over Zoom, and they was telling me about their early, what was it like coming to Wolverhampton? They said it was all dark and dreary, they saw lots of chimneys, that generation, my parents' generation, they were suited and booted, they just brought vitality and energy and infused, not just, this is like what happened, not just in Wolverhampton, but throughout the country, wherever there was a Caribbean community, they just added that vitality and energy, and then obviously in terms of Southeast Asian communities. And this, often people don't really understand and appreciate our contribution, their contribution as migrants, as who saw the country as a motherland, and making that contribution. That's why I was quite heavily involved in campaigning for National Windrush Day, which we eventually got on the back of the Windrush scandal.
Can I do a little plug here?
Sure.
Earlier today, myself and a great local actor, Jeanette Barrett, actually were in the same space, and we had a wonderful picture called Nurse Brown from Jamaica, which was painted in 1956 by a local white artist.
Yes.
The gallery here bought it in 1968, and if you remember, 1968 was the Rivers of Blood speech, so I think that was a political gesture on
That's
their part.
That's interesting.
Yeah, I think it's very pointed of them. It's a wonderful painting, and the first time I saw it, I wondered whether I could actually bring it to more people's attention.
Yeah.
Because you will appreciate, 1956, not many working class women were having their painting, their pictures painted, let alone nurses, let alone black nurses.
Yes.
So it's an absolute gem. It's a lovely picture as well. So what we've done, the plug is that we had it filmed by the people who are filming us now, today, and it will go out on from Monday, the 15th, is it, for a week.
Okay.
And although you don't get charged for it, you have to book. But it is about Nurse Brown and about her life.
Yes.
It also mentions Paulette Wilson.
Okay.
Because both Jeanette and I feel she's a wonderful person and deserves the kind of acknowledgement that you're talking about.
Yes.
And I mean, there are different ways of being acknowledged. Mm-hmm. And so a blue plaque would be wonderful, but she's also mentioned in my play, which, as I said, if people want to see it. And then hopefully when we're able to go back into a gallery again, the picture will be out once more and people can see it.
Yeah.
But it is such a young woman come from Jamaica. That's the name of the title of the painting.
Yes.
In 1956, 8 years after the founding of the National Health Service.
Yes.
8 years, you know.
Yeah.
And she is there in her uniform, so confident and lively.
Mm.
And it's a beautiful picture to see that feistiness, that readiness to take on the world.
I wish I could have a copy. Can I have a copy?
I don't have it just
no,
with
no,
me.
No,
but,
no.
But no.
Let's,
the gallery,
I think it's brilliant. I think, I mean, and it's quite, the question is it a real person, or is it? So you found the fan, it is. Oh, fantastic.
Yeah, we know it is, but we don't know whether she's still alive, for example, because she would be in her 80s.
Yeah.
And we think she might be called Ivy Brown, but we don't know that either. Royal College of Nursing did some work looking for it when it was shown in London to find out. And unfortunately, because of her age, we think we may have lost her. For goodness sake, if anybody knows Ivy Brown, you know, let us know and let the gallery know.
Yeah. It's interesting, because my mother's maiden name is Brown. And she came to Wolverhampton in 1959, and she worked in the eye infirmary. And so I don't know if.
But your mother doesn't. Have you asked your mother?
No, but she. I mean, she didn't have many relatives coming from Jamaica at that time. So she, you know, cause all her siblings were mainly in Jamaica. Were either in Jamaica or they went to America. So. No, we would have known about that, but Brown's is a common name anyway.
There's something fascinating, and this is a link with Paulette, actually.
Yeah.
Because what first attracted me to the picture is the symbol with her hands that she is making. And I had various thoughts about it.
Okay.
And when I checked it out with people who know better than me, I was told that it was a Rastafarian symbol for the Lion of Judah.
Yeah.
And I actually saw Natalie, Paulette's daughter, making the self-same symbol at the funeral of her mother.
Sure, yes.
And I was fascinated by that because this is 1956. I mean, I don't know very much about Rastafarianism, but again, she must have been quite an individual in her painting to actually deliberately make that sign.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. Well,
she was a real person, right?
That's interesting. Let's try and find her. Let's try and track her down and find who she is.
Love to.
Yeah.
Okay. But you can watch it from Monday for a week for free as part of the Literature Festival. So that was my plug. Now then, what else have we got? There was something that... what about George Africanus, another of my hobby horses?
Okay, yeah. Well, I suppose it goes back to the history of the slave trade in Wolverhampton. And I think George Africanus is interesting. Obviously, he was bought by or owned by the Molyneux family. Obviously linked to the Molyneux house, and then obviously we've got the Molyneux football stadium, Wolves. And what interesting thing about George Africanus, after he left Wolverhampton, he settled in Nottingham. So there's a blue plaque of George Africanus in Nottingham. And I know that you've been looking at the idea of having a blue plaque in Wolverhampton. I think we should go for that. I think it's really important because, I mean, he's probably one of the earliest, in terms of black presence in Wolverhampton. He's probably, I mean, there might be, he's one of the earliest people that we know. It might be even earlier, but I don't know.
Well, in the church's records, which are always useful, of course, we have George and we have his baptism, and he's stated that he's 3 years old.
Yeah.
A Negro boy of Benjamin Molyneux, it actually says in the record.
Yeah.
I've had a little look, and there are a couple of people who are also identified about the same time. So that was 1766, as being black, because whoever was doing the baptisms, and as you know, Patrick, because people have been enslaved and brought against their will to Britain, then sometimes families thought that actually they would make Christians of people.
Yeah.
I mean, quite what those people thought about that, I don't know, but it happened. And when it happened, if you were made as an adult, it was very likely it would be noted.
Yes.
So we've got a couple of other people, and don't ask me their names because it was a while ago, who are identified about the same time as George, as being in Wolverhampton. It's fascinating to wonder, because the Molyneux would have let him out occasionally from serving them in the house, whether he bumped into people in the street or not.
I mean, interesting. It'd be interesting to explore that history. What was Wolverhampton like in the 18th century? And you know, I mean, there's lots of work done in London about the black presence in the 18th century. You have George, you had the likes of Equiano, Cogano, the Sons of Africa, all living in, based in the Clapham area. So it'd be interesting to...
Clapham.
So it'd be interesting to explore that. And they used to go to the debates in Parliament as Wilberforce was pushing through his legislation around ending the Slave Trade Act of 1807. They were there. They actually attended those debates in the gallery.
Well, of course, Equiano is very important because we hear a lot about Wilberforce, and he's the classic great white saviour, as it were.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, he had access to Parliament, but Equiano did a tremendous amount. He went all over the country.
Yeah, I mean,
didn't
that's the thing. I think Equiano's unsung hero. I think he played an important role. I see him as a great great grandfather of black civil rights in Britain. To be quite honest, he wrote. Wrote his memoirs, he toured the country, and he was quite an extraordinary person. And he's featured actually in the book I've co-written with my colleague, Dr. Angeline Osborne, 100 Great Black Britons. He's featured in there, and also a whole range of other people who were campaigners and abolitionists as well. But in terms of going back to blue plaques, I mean, when I did my campaign, 100 Great Black Britons, about 17 years ago, the one person that came joint second was someone from Wolverhampton, Reverend Oliver Lysite, founder of the New Testament Church of God, first black-led church to be established in Britain in 1953, and he was in Wolverhampton. So when he came joint second, I remember I was invited, I think the Wolverhampton Local Civic Society, I don't know if you've got a name, Civic Society?
Well, they've changed recently.
I don't know what the name is, but anyway, I was invited to do a talk because they do all the blue plaques in Wolverhampton, so I did the talk.
Oh, yes, that's right. And it's called the Wolverhampton Society now.
Wolverhampton Society. So they invited me to do a talk for Black History Month about 4 or 5 years ago, and I did a presentation, talked about the history of the Jamaican community in Wolverhampton, and then when it came to Q&A, and then I said, I've got a question for you, by the way. Not you. I was talking to them.
Oh, sorry.
As we were drinking wine, as we were drinking in Down Penn, no, down Tetnal Road.
I said,
I've got a question for you, Society. I've been onto your website, and you've got loads of blue plaques. They seem to be all dead white men, with all due respect.
Mm-hmm.
Where are the black and Asian people that, in terms of blue plaques? And they all kind of looked around, scratching their heads. And I said, what can you recommend then? I said, yeah, I could give you loads of names. For starters, you can start with Oliver Reverend Lysite, who came joint second in Great Black Britain's campaign I ran in 2004. So we worked with them, worked with the Lysite family, the Harvest Temple, New Testament Church of God in Heathtown. And we got in, I think it was 2013, 2014, we got a blue plaque unveiled in Heathtown Church, still there. And that is the first blue plaque of a person of colour in Wolverhampton. So I think in Wolverhampton, we've got a lot of work to do to acknowledge not only the black experience in Wolverhampton, but also the Southeast Asian experience and other communities' experience. Mm. When I go to Wolverhampton and you walk around Wolverhampton, you wouldn't think that we contribute to Wolverhampton at all. There's nothing visible in the public realm that denotes that we've been here and we've contributed, basically. And so I think, you know, the challenge I like to see is we need to do more work on that.
Is this your provocation to the council?
This is my provocation to the council, and my provocation to philanthropists in Wolverhampton, and my provocation to the public, and to the communities themselves. We need to have more visibility around. Yeah, it's not about churches and godwellers and temples. It's about celebrating and acknowledging people of colour in Wolverhampton who have made a difference. And there have been loads of people from all communities, but it's not visible. In this gallery, they launched, and it's unfortunate because of COVID, they launched the BME project. They did the oral history project. So here we've got the fantastic film footage, oral histories of people from the Women's Generation, and they've got other archive stuff from Southeast Asian communities as well. I know that you mentioned to me about in Wolverhampton University, which I work closely with the university, and you said they've got a department of Punjab Sikh studies?
Sikh studies, yes.
Which is fantastic. And so we need to have more works. I mean, I grew up very closely. I mean, all my friends were Sikhs growing up at primary school, and actually the junior school I went to was actually the one that was Grove Junior School, and that was Enoch Powell's involved in opening that in 68, and I was there at the time. So, you know, I think we need to do more history, celebrating the history of Wolverhampton. You know, if you go to Waterstones of Wolverhampton, it's not open now, obviously, but if you were to go towards, and you go to a local history section, you will hardly, and you look at all the books written about local history in Wolverhampton, you will, there's hardly any mention about the black presence, or black people, or Asian people, or anyone that's contributed. You might see the odd image in the background of a black or Asian person, and that's about it. So we've got more work to do on that.
I do agree, and here we go again with plays, because last year this gallery, was it last year? 2019 actually, had a play in this room, which is about the Sikh community in Wolverhampton called Himmat, and which is courage in Punjabi. That was about an incident which many people don't know about. That I wrote it because I found out about it in, oh God, was it 69? 67 to 69. It's a big campaign by the Sikh community in Wolverhampton, in Britain, and internationally, and in India, so that Sikh drivers could actually wear beards and turbans on the buses, because this borough at that time wouldn't allow it.
Yes.
So, and there was a successful campaign that people won, and it's so good to have a feel-good story like that, where people got what they wanted. So I did a play on that one, and the gallery hosted that. Arts Council funding. Yes, I'm aware that there is large and important Sikh community in particular, is the one I know. I mean, obviously it's Muslim community, Hindus and so forth in Wolverhampton. And yes, you wouldn't know necessarily. Smethwick, however, has got a big statue recently unveiled of a soldier, because you again will know about this. For it wasn't that long ago when people were told, you don't think the world wars were an all-white effort, do you? That there were many people, I mean, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
I mean, obviously, in terms of, I mean, there's been more work done over the last 10, 15 years. I've been involved in some projects myself. I've worked closely with the Imperial War Museum in London. I'm one of their fellows, and...
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I'm one of their fellows. Yeah, because I've worked with them, I've worked with them on various projects around the interpretation of their objects, and also to, you know, in terms of having more of the visibility of the African and Caribbean contribution to First World War, Second World War. I made a documentary some years ago called Charm Life about, and that was the life of about Eddie Martin Noble, who served in the Second World War. Actually, one last time I came here was properly, I showed the film here at the art gallery, and guess who was my guest? And guess who was my guest of honour? Paulette Wilson and her daughter. We showed that film. But we have more work to do, definitely. I mean, in terms of even my own family history, my dad's told me that one of his great uncles served in the First World War, and another family, distant relatives, got involved in the Second World War. So in households, in black households and other and Southeast Asian households, we are involved and contribute to the war effort. But unfortunately, you don't see that. It's not that visible at all. So again, more work needs to be done on that, and especially in a place like Wolverhampton as well.
Did you know this gallery, and I've had this sort of loose association with the gallery for a number of years and think highly of it.
Yeah.
It's got, by the way, you'll know this, links to the black artists who came out of Wolverhampton Polytechnic in the early 70s, I think.
No, 80s.
I'm not very good at this.
My sister was involved in that. My sister, Janet.
Was she?
Yeah, because she studied at Poly. And the black, it was called Black Art Collective. And actually, one of the main people behind that was Eddie Chambers, who was actually in the same class at me at school. Yeah. We went to Colton Hills. So Eddie, Keith Piper, I remember when they had the launch of the exhibition. Actually, I went to it, and it was in 1981. Just before,
Black art and done. Black art. I can't remember.
So it was officially opened. It was the first exhibition they had here in the Wolverhampton Art Gallery in 1981. It was actually about the same time as the riots that were taking place in Britain, and there were little riots in Wolverhampton with Marines. And what was funny, the Express and Star wrote this article. I can remember it. They said that that this exhibition had influenced people to riot in Wolverhampton.
Oh yes, of course.
I mean, with all due respect, I think not many black people knew about the art gallery in the first place. Never least start to be inspired to riot, which I found quite amusing actually.
Well, there's a wonderful painting by Doncor, I can never remember his first name, which you know, I'm sure, which is very political, which the gallery has, which is Madonna Metropolitan, The Death of Cynthia Jarrett.
Oh yeah.
Have you seen that one?
I've not seen that one. I've not seen that one, but one of the members of the Black Art Collective, who passed away some years ago, his name just escaped me, he did an installation on the life of Clinton McIrvine. Who was murdered, I have to say, by the police in Wolverhampton in next clothes shop in February 1987. And that murder has not, and the police have not been called to account on that, which is outrageous, so 30 years on.
So you feel that that's in a sort of minor key, maybe, Wolverhampton's moment, as in America, George Floyd's death is so...
The sad thing about it, the reason why I know a lot about the murder of, and I use the word murder deliberately, of Clinton McIrvine, is because I just came out of law school, and I was actually involved in the campaign. It was probably my first campaign I got involved in as an activist, and I was working with to try and find the witnesses. There were a number of eyewitnesses who saw what happened. So this is the official story, which not many people know about. There was a black guy that went into the next clothes shop with a stolen credit card. And if you remember back in those days, in the 80s, when you had a credit card, they would have to ring somewhere. They'd go in the stock room and make a phone call to see if your card was kosher. If you can remember that. It's different now,
basically,
isn't it?
I don't think they let me have one.
So anyway, this person had a stolen credit card. And obviously, when they went to the back room to do the phone call, he legged it. But the person, they called the police, and Clinton McIrvine, a few minutes later, walked into the shop, looking around. The police arrived. They automatically assumed he was the person that stole with a card. They just jumped on him. One officer sat on his legs. One officer sat on his stomach. And another officer did an arm around his neck. And he was struggling on the floor in the shop. And one of the eyewitnesses told me what he said. And guess what he said? This is in 1987, February the 20th, 1987. Guess what he said?
The policeman?
No, Clinton McIrvine.
Oh my God, the same as George Floyd.
Just before he died, he struggled and said, "I can't breathe." That's happened in Wolverhampton over 30 years ago.
I didn't know it was the exact words.
Yeah. That's what he said, "I can't breathe." So we don't need to go to America. We've got enough stories and experiences on justice here as well. And I know that the Bandung file was part of Channel 4. They made a program on the murder. I was involved in that, and they interviewed family and a whole range of stuff. And I think it's time for there to be a new inquest to look into the whole case. And the murder of Clinton McIrvine, seriously, I think it's important. If everyone can change create their EDI policies and have statements supporting Black Lives Matter on the murder of George Floyd in America, why can't we have something here and the place of all places in Wolverhampton. I think the council have not even done recognised the murder of George Floyd and the injustices of the black community in Wolverhampton. They've not even done nothing at all, which is outrageous.
I'm wondering what you think they might do, mind you. What sort of thing would you expect them to do as a council?
Well, I think the council, they closed down the cultural centre, made it into a car park. I mean, obviously that was a different administration. But the problem is...
It's the African Caribbean cultures.
The cultural centre, it's a car park. They closed it down, deliberately raised the building, made it into a car park.
Yeah,
that shows the contempt that happened in the black community in Wolverhampton. And luckily, a number of people got together, raised money and bought the Heritage Centre, which was the former Conservative head party quarters,
yes.
which is history reversing itself.
Wasn't it Powell's actual office, have I got that wrong?
Yeah, that's where Enoch Powell, that was his constituents' office, and allegedly that's where he wrote his speech, Rivers of Blood. So how it's really interesting how history
ironic
comes back
what?
Again.
Gosh.
Empire Strikes Back, as I say.
Right. So, there's such a lot, isn't there, out there? And people might say, you know, what is there to know? Well, there is a lot to know.
I think there's a whole undercurrent history in Wolverhampton, which we need to spend, that we need to do more work on. We need to have likes of you, myself, also David Bennett from the Black Wolverhampton Black History Project, who has got a fantastic, he's been painstakingly for the last 40 years, or maybe even less than that, has painstakingly collected a whole range of newspaper articles, objects and information about the black experience in Wolverhampton. And I hope that one day there's an opportunity for that to be showcased for everyone to see.
Well, that's at Penderford, isn't that? In he
lives in Penderford, but obviously he's got massive, I've seen some of his stuff, and some of the stuff he's actually shared with me as well. And I think we've got a lot of work to do. I know that Wolverhampton Archives has recently got some funding and they've got the BME Archive, history.
Yeah.
They've got the LGBT history and they're going to try and showcase that. But I think we need to do more work in Wolverhampton particularly about the black experience in terms of churches, about social life, about the politics. There have been loads of campaigns for many, many decades in Wolverhampton. As well. So often people always gravitate and think about Notting Hill riots, they think about Brixton, we've got just as powerful narrative here in Wolverhampton, basically.
Well, when I came to Wolverhampton in the 70s, the National Front were very big town. And this is before your time, I think, isn't it? Because
I remember the National Front. They used to have marches quite regularly in the town centre in the 70s and early 80s, and I lived in the All Saints area, and they used to kind of march quite regularly around the area because it was a large area of black and Asian people. So, you know, we've seen firsthand of it's terrorism. They terrorize you, creating the fear, a culture of fear. And then there used to be guys driving around Wolverhampton town centre with air pistols, and they would shoot at black and Asian people.
Well, they did indeed.
You know.
And famously, a couple of young black men were actually hurt.
Yeah.
And I was the secretary of the Wolverhampton Anti-Racist Committee, as it happened,
yes.
Which was certainly not white-led. It was white, Asian, black,
Wolfronians. Yeah,
and one of the nights, that was bad.
Yeah.
But it was immediately challenged by people in Wolverhampton. We had, as a committee, organised various important black and Asian organisations involved our demonstrations against the front at that stage. So that was a good thing.
Yes.
And but Wolverhampton is never sort of seen by the media as being important. So any struggles that there are in this city, I think, tend to get forgotten.
Yeah. But also, we've got heroes as well. I mean, you know, we've got Tessa Sanderson, we've got my good friend Beverly Knight.
You know Beverly.
Yeah. I mean, obviously with Jamila, she's originally from Wolverhampton, but she's more Birmingham.
Yeah.
You know, you've got the Wolverhampton judo team at one stage dominated the British judo team in terms of the Olympics and especially the Moscow Olympics in 1980. You know, we've got a whole range of talent and creative people in Wolverhampton, but people don't know that.
Absolutely. I mean, believe, although there's been a tendency, as often happens, for black young people to go to London because that's where the jobs are.
Yes.
But in fact, Wolverhampton has got an important black community in terms of the number of people. People think about Bristol, for example, and Liverpool. But I mean, Wolves, as you say, it's also lively.
It is lively, but a lot of people have left Wolverhampton to better themselves. Lots of us. There's been a brain drain of black talent that's
left. You went, didn't you?
But I'm still here. I do come to Wolverhampton.
Of course
I've got
do.
My family here. I've got my parents, sisters, nephews, great nieces, and that kind of stuff. But there is that drain. And actually, ironically, if you were to see the most successful black people in Britain, they're all from the Midlands and the North, believe it or not.
What about Olusuga?
Huh?
David Olusuga.
He's from Newcastle.
Is he really?
Yeah, he's based in Bristol, but he grew up in Newcastle.
Yeah, okay.
So seriously, that's your homework. I've got a copy of the book for you, 100 Great Black Britons. You do your homework and find out who's come from the Midlands and North, and you'll find that a large portion of successful black people in Britain have come from the Midlands and North.
Which is
and just, you know.
But you see, the media down south don't really take much notice of the Midlands and the North, do they? So that's one of the reasons, I suppose.
You know, it's really interesting because people always laugh at Wolverhampton. I don't know why. I mean, you know.
It's a long name, isn't it?
Yeah, I know. But they don't really, so I get very defensive. And that's why when it comes to people saying, when I get accused, I don't understand the history of the black country, I say, of course I do. When I'm in London, I always represent Wolverhampton and the black country. Because it's important, because there's lots of, even if you look at, Slade, I love, the band, you've got, Nigel Rawls, the writer. I mean, there's lots of people who have come out of
Wolverhampton. Caitlin Moran. Not that I've read her work, by the way.
But there's a whole, so there's a whole range of talent that's come out.
Absolutely.
Black, white, Asian have come out of Wolverhampton. And
Satnam Sangira.
Of course, yeah, and his book's just come out quite recently, which I'm reading, on Empire. I mean, there's lots of talent. There is,
can I stop you at that point? You're actually reading it.
I'm just starting to read
it. Because it looks quite heavy to me. Because do you remember the title? It's quite a long title. I mention it because Satnam's also involved with the Lit Fest.
Is he involved? I don't know when he's speaking. This might be probably later on in the week.
He may have done it already.
I don't know. But yeah, I think it'd be quite good for the festival organisers. Hi, Georgina. But for the festival to organise a kind of a conversation of people, to have a conversation around this history of Wolverhampton, and to break it down from different perspectives. Maybe you could.
Can I come, please?
Yeah. I mentioned this to James from the Express and Star. I'm sure James is online watching tonight. We should have a conversation to explore this. Because I think there's a rich tapestry of history. There's lots of contentions, different provocations. But I think it'd be quite a rich conversation to have.
I think that's brilliant, because even though I'm not a Wolverhampton myself, I've been fascinated by the city ever since I came here.
Yeah.
I think it's a great little city.
Yes.
I think it does get ignored. I think it's terrible that it's a bit of a music hall joke amongst white media types.
Yes.
And I think that giving it its due would be fabulous. It's James Vukmirovic.
Yeah, that's it, James.
There you go. Another
James, I've spoken to James about that as well. But sadly, going back to Paulette Wilson, because of the whole Wondrous scandal, and Paulette was one of the main, I would see her as one of the main people that inspired hundreds, if not thousands,
Absolutely.
Of individuals to share their stories about the hostile environment. And she, in a funny way, she helped put Wolverhampton on the map for different reasons, but she helped put Wolverhampton on the map. And that's why it's important that we have a legacy of her and have a blue plaque to commemorate her contribution.
And as you know, I want one for George Africanus as well. But
we need one for George Africanus.
He died a long time ago, so Paulette only died recently. And I interrupted you.
No, that's fine. It's fine.
No. So we could go on talking.
But yes, is it question time now?
I don't know. I'm not in charge of that bit.
Okay.
It depends, because I promised that we could go on nattering for some time, because we had such a lot of interest between us because of my plays, for example. And you're going to watch Nurse Brown from Jamaica.
Oh, absolutely.
Jamaica,
I'm looking forward to
week.
That. Definitely. Great.
But I think we might have Georgina coming.
Yeah. So we do have a few questions. In audience, please do keep
asking your questions via Twitter using hashtag at Patrick V. So one of our questions is, why do you think there hasn't been much progress until now on decolonization of our shared heritage?
I think because we're going to start the conversation, and I'm not in Wolverhampton all the time, so you might be in a better place than me, but we need to start the conversation around decolonising. I know in Hackney, where I used to be a councillor in Hackney, and I worked closely with the council and community activists, and there'd been a big conversation in Hackney about decolonising. One of the first things they did on the back of the murder of George Floyd and the removal of the Coulson statue, the council have initiated a process to review in the borough of Hackney all the monuments and objects in the public realm which has links to the slave trade. Yeah. And actually, Lambeth Council have done that, a number of local authorities have done that, and just recently Sadiq Khan, the Mayor of London, has just appointed a commission to look across the whole of London to look at, not just around the objects that around slavery, but objects that might offend, that might be sexist, homophobic, etc. So they're doing this commission, and in the early work that's been done in Hackney, City Business School, they decided to get rid of the name of Caseland, because Caseland was a slave trader. Mm. Robert Jeffrey, the Museum of the Home, which used to be called the Jeffrey Museum, he was a slave trader, yes. Very similar to Colston. And the museum itself did a public consultation working with the council, and vast majority of the public wanted to have the Jeffrey Museum statue, which is an essential part of the open at the entrance, to be removed. But I heard otherwise.
The trustees don't like the idea, I think.
No, what I heard otherwise, that the trustees supported the idea, but the government, they were threatened by DCMS that if you remove the statue, we're going to cut your funding. So
disgraceful.
I'll put it on record now. That's what I heard.
Typical of this Tory government.
So going back to Wolverhampton, I think Wolverhampton Council should start a process. I mean, there's probably not that many statues anyway, but they could still do it. They could start a process to look at and have an inquiry, a process, a review to look at all the statues, monuments in the public realm of Wolverhampton, which has links to the slave trade. And to do that work, you'd have to do commission some research work to look at the objects and stuff like that. And I'm sure, in terms of the philanthropists that were involved in Wolverhampton in the 17th and 18th century, they would have been involved in the slave trade. So let's do that.
The Molyneux were involved in rum trade with Jamaica. That's not the slave trade as such, but they got a slave boy out of it. Yes.
Yeah, but the rum was used on. We can split hairs if we want to.
Yeah.
Let's explore it, and etc.
The triangular trade. Yeah. Yes.
So let's explore that. So I think that's what needs to happen. Then in terms of the educational authority, what are they doing around Blackish Month?
Yes.
So going back to Hackney, every single year, the council has inset days, and they have a subject matter each year on Black History Month, and they work with artists and theatre people like yourself, and they go into schools as part of a regular programme on Black History Month. Does Wolverhampton do that? Do they have a regular programme of going into schools, working with creatives, and creating stuff? Hackney Council have just launched their own curriculum on Black History. So these are just some examples that are happening already that I know. And so that's a challenge for the council and other key stakeholders to start that process.
Just a quick one about the art gallery. Bethany, who works here, has been in touch with me about an exhibition that they're hoping to have about decolonization and about links to slavery. So she's been talking to me about George Africanus, for example.
Okay.
But the art gallery will be putting something on, so they are working already.
So when I say the council, I know that art gallery is doing fantastic work. I'm talking about in terms of policy.
Yeah, sure.
I'm talking about policy, political direction. That's what I mean.
Sure.
Is there any particular historical figure you think needs more light shined on them? Some more celebrating or?
More historical figure? I mean, in terms of Wolverhampton or
Wolverhampton.
What, Well, I think, like I said before, there's been a lot of black talent in Wolverhampton over the years. And I think what would be fantastic if there was like a major exhibition or even a commissioned piece to celebrate that and to have a conversation with the public, to be involved in that. And to
so rather than an actual one individual, because we've talked about quite a lot, haven't we?
I think it's actually looking at celebrating the black presence in Wolverhampton. And I think what we need actually is a book. We need a kind of a heavy tone book which celebrates that history. So when you go into Waterstones, or the town hall, the civic centre, I should say, or the art gallery, or any place, or all the schools in Wolverhampton, there is a book about the black history and contribution and presence in Wolverhampton. That's what we need.
You're the main man here, it's not me, but it seems to me that the black artists from the Polytechnic ought to be much better known than they are, for example, as a group.
Ironically, the black art movement, which has started in Wolverhampton, and also some people from Birmingham, is more recognised in London than in Wolverhampton. And internationally as well.
Really?
Yes, absolutely.
Internationally, certainly.
Yeah, as well, yeah. Gosh. So we don't even celebrate our own. There was an exhibition a couple of years ago, and that was great. But there should be some kind of permanent legacy to celebrate
absolutely.
That. So my niece, she's at Wolverhampton University. She's just completed the first degree. She's doing a master's. And she's been inspired by my sister, her auntie, who was part of that black arts movement. So that, just imagine how many other young people could be inspired.
I agree with you about people here not knowing about it. Yeah.
Yeah.
And they're amazingly important people.
Absolutely, yeah.
Internationally. Keith Piper, for example, is well known.
Yeah, so that's what we should do. A book, the movie, statues, what else?
That'll be something to start with.
Okay then.
And then we have another question that says, does Patrick think that the Black Lives Matter protests in the summer have caused a sea of change in the way people are thinking and acting?
Has there been a sea change?
Yeah, has there been a sea of change?
Has there been a sea of change? There's been seeds of change. If you ask that question this time next year, I might have a better answer. There's a journalist from Huffington Post recently wrote an article a few months ago, and she looked at all the pledges that were made last summer. So remember, all of a sudden, all these big corporates were saying, you know, Black Lives Matter, everyone's doing a knee. Everyone made these big statements to say that we want to tackle issues around discrimination and white privilege and all that blah. And she looked and she did an audit to see 6 months on, have they done anything? And half of them haven't.
What a surprise!
But some have.
More surprising.
But lots of them just had this knee-jerk reaction. Let's put our statement of solidarity and support. But you know, words can be cheap. It's about follow through and commitment, basically. So that's why I use seeds, because there are some organisations who are going through a journey and through a process, and some organisations are doing nothing at all, and some organisations are just doing lip service. So time will tell if this will be changed. One of my observations, if you look at the history of Britain and the black experience, lived experience, every 20, 30 years, there's a moment in history where everyone says, we must do something.
Mm.
It happened with the Windrush scandal a couple of years ago, and we're still waiting for justice.
Mm.
Prior to that, it was the murder of Stephen Lawrence, and everyone said, we must change that, and we're changing law. So every 20, ever so often, there's a kind of a moment where people say, we must do something, and then nothing, and then we go back to the same old.
Mm.
Maybe it could be different, because with the impact of COVID-19, and the severity of the deaths, which has had a major impact, particularly not only with the whole population of Britain, you know, we've had about 130,000 deaths, and its disproportionate impact on black and Asian communities, and the way that we're now having this event, it should have been like maybe 40, 50 people here having a conversation.
Indeed.
But, you know, so this is our new normal, and it's going to happen for a little while. Is this means that we're going to look at society differently? Are we going to treat people with more respect, more dignity? Are we going to be more inclusive as a society? Black Lives Matter only came out this time round because the world stood still and saw the murder of George Floyd for 8 minutes and 43 seconds. And people were forced to stay still. and be silent and to observe. Will that change? I don't know, but I hope it does, I really do.
So that Black Lives Matter, in a way, is a good thing which has come out of COVID, but of course, we must make sure that, as you say, all this lip service which is coming out from capitalist organisations.
Yeah, well, see what happens. I mean, I think Black Lives Matter didn't come out of just pure, I mean, it's been going as a global entity for a number of years, but because of COVID-19 and the world stood still, it's like one of these sci-fi movies, and you were forced, you can't do anything, you have to watch, you have to observe, and that's what people did. And it was the first time ever that a lot of white people said, we didn't realise that you experienced racism, we didn't realise it was that bad. Well, we've been telling you this for the last 40 years. My parents have been talking about this since I came into Britain, but you've not listened to us. But now, because people had to observe and stand still and to listen, people have. So let's see if we can build on that. Let's see if we can take that forward.
Thank you so much. That was the last question. And we're thank you so much to Jefny and Patrick for joining us today at the Wolverhampton Literature Festival. And I do hope that everyone, all our audience, have enjoyed this talk. Thank you.